Access Nashville with Katie Couric.
Hi everyone, I'm Katie Couric, and as you can see, it's Girls Night Out. Over the years, these incredible queens of country have torched and twanged, strummed and strutted their way into our lives. And topping the charts these days is Taylor Swift. She's packed a lot into her 22 years, as I found out when I headed to her stomping grounds in Nashville. Taylor keeps turning her life story into lyrics, and those lyrics into hits we just can't get out of our heads. Once you hear it, you can't forget it. Taylor Swift has done it again. Both her album Red and her chart-topping anthem, We Are Never Ever Getting Back Together, are already number one in 32 countries. I joined her where her career really began, in Nashville at the Country Music Hall of Fame and Museum. It's where, at just 14, she signed her first record deal.
Thank you for saying that.
It's fine.
It's also where Taylor recently donated $4 million to fund a new education center.
Thank you.
It's her way to connect with country music's storied past while ensuring the next generation keeps it going strong.
Are you ready?
On display, dresses and items from Taylor's last tour, Speak Now, the top-grossing country music tour of last year. All that glitters, all that burns, and even the flying balcony, all conjured up by the vivid imagination of Taylor Swift.
That must be fun, though, coming up with these things that are really going to wow people. That'll make every song kind of an adventure, right?
Going through these performances, it's like an athletic marathon, kind of. When I'm like down in underneath the stage and it pops me up like a toaster and I'm like 6 feet in the air. Okay, made it through that. Did the banjo solo. Okay, on to this. Next blocking, change clothes. Okay, cool. Flying above the crowd. Awesome. Coming out of a bell. You just kind of get into a cycle of it. And it's fun.
Do you ever worry though you're gonna forget or screw up?
All the time.
Oh my gosh, there's so much to think about.
And
by the way,
everything.
You're singing and dancing too, right?
Yes. And that's kind of the nature of a live performance. You know, things could go wrong. That's part of the excitement of being there.
For Taylor, life itself is exciting.
Taylor Swift!
She's the reigning CMA Awards Entertainer of the Year and the proud owner of 6 Grammys. It's a crowning collection of prestigious acronyms from ACM, CMT, AMA, and of course, MTV.
Welcome.
How are you? I come bearing gifts of the season.
Wow.
Here's a pumpkin for you.
Thank you.
Taylor invited me back to her home in Nashville. I even brought some Halloween costumes for her beloved cat, Meredith.
Oh my God, that's crazy. That is insane. I'm so excited. Thank you. Thank you.
You live by yourself. Do you ever get a little lonely?
Not really. I do really well on my own. I like to watch TV, hang out with my cat, go hiking. It's fine.
Yeah, and I think it's nice because you're around people so much. It must be nice for you to spend some time just chilling.
It's kind of nice. You're right. There's like sort of a committee everywhere.
Hi.
You need a committee to keep her business venture straight. In addition to her music career, she's taken on acting.
We haven't seen that one.
And turned her CoverGirl looks into a CoverGirl contract.
Easy, breezy, beautiful blast lipstick from CoverGirl.
There's even a fragrance line.
The beginning of something magical.
Is it enough to be a great singer, songwriter, performer, or do you have to be somebody who can market yourself and actually develop a whole brand?
You become a brand as soon as you sell one thing. So you can either recognize it and embrace it, or you can deny it and pretend it's not happening.
Taylor Swift, the brand, is the charmed evolution of the little girl who grew up on a Christmas tree farm in Pennsylvania, then moved with her family to Nashville to get her big break. A 2-year-old Taylor was singing a classic in this home video, but after receiving a guitar for Christmas, her world changed. Soon at 12 years old, she would write her first song, Lucky You, and start performing for anyone who would listen. These days, the songwriter's best friend is her iPhone.
I'll get an idea. I don't have time to say to the person I'm with, hey, I gotta go do this real quick. I just pick up my phone, I go to a corner of the room, and I'm like, this is a fan's phone. Like, just this weird fragment of, like, melody, a few words, kind of like some beat. Like, it's really, you don't want to listen to them. They're weird.
They must be like, what is she doing?
And they'll be like, was that what I think it was? And I'll be like, yeah, I'm going to write that tonight.
With over 20 million Twitter followers and 35 million Facebook friends, Taylor's a total techie. So of course it makes perfect sense she'd announce her new album with a web chat.
And you told your fans that when it comes to the emotions that you write about, you say they're all pretty much about the kind of tumultuous, insane, and crazy, intense, semi-toxic relationships that I've experienced in the last 2 years.
To put it lightly.
Yeah. Gee, that doesn't sound like a very fun 2 years, Miss Taylor Swift.
Well, it starts out fun. There's always got to be like a little bit of glimmer of good for a relationship to go bad for you to miss it. Afraid to write about it. I'm really gonna miss
you picking fights. And write about it she does. With each new hit comes the new guessing game. Is it John Mayer, Joe Jonas, Taylor Lautner, or Jake Gyllenhaal? Which famous Taylor X is the song really about? And is a scarf just a scarf? Or is it a clue connected to a scarf she wore while photographed with Jake Gyllenhaal?
People sort of speculate, they imagine, they think they get clues.
They kind of draw their own story.
You're wearing a scarf in music video and everyone's like, gee, that scarf looks like the scarf she was wearing when she was photographed with Jake Gyllenhaal, perhaps.
You know,
it's funny, right?
For me, the one thing that I keep really close is the identity of who these songs are about.
Is it sometimes hard to get people to come into your world? Because I don't know, if I hung out with you, I'd be a little afraid you were gonna write a song about me.
The only time that's been an issue is when I was like going through a really bad breakup with a guy and he's like, you better not write about this. And I'm like, oh, I won't.
Did you?
Yes.
Do you ever hear from these people who maybe recognize themselves in a song and are like, hi, guess what? I really didn't appreciate that.
Well, they don't say it that gracefully or that with that kind of an eloquent tone. If they're not liking what's written about them or what they think is written about them or what they assume and presume is about them, I probably hit the nail right on the head. It's probably really true.
Coming up,
Taylor, you know I'm gonna have to ask you about the love of your life, right?
And find out what question led to this.
Whoa, that's such a hard question.
When we come back. Talk to your friends, talk to my friends. The global launch of Taylor Swift's new album, Red, was crafted with platinum precision.
From
the buzz-building announcement.
Do you like it?
To the international pre-tour, crescendoing to a launch week frenzy. Note orchestrated to help Red break records.
Is this a really nerve-wracking time for you?
Almost every time for me is a nerve-wracking time for me because I will find the pressure in every situation and think about it. And my life has become sort of a constant balancing act between, you know, like hope and fear and like faith and worrying and like, you know, being nervous about this album I've worked really hard on and like being proud of this album I've worked really hard on.
For Taylor, her hard work usually pays off big time. She's the only female artist to release 3 number one albums in a row, each selling more than 5 million copies. Numbers only matched by the likes of the Beatles and Michael Jackson. With such a history of unprecedented success, a new album brings new pressures.
I know the last thing you want to be called is predictable, right?
It's really important for me, for my fans to trust me and to not go so far in the opposite direction that they don't recognize me anymore. It's trying to evolve. It's trying to try new things without becoming a new thing.
Taylor first became a star as a teen, innocently singing among butterflies about first kisses. But she's trying not to grow up too fast.
How do you kind of transition from that young girl to a more mature artist?
I think a mistake that sometimes gets made when there's pressure to grow up, you look at that artist and you think, you didn't have to grow up 10 years in a month. You didn't, no, that wasn't what you had to do.
Like, you didn't have to go boom.
Yeah, I wanna live a life and I wanna live my life 1 year at a time, and when I'm 22, I want to be 22. When I'm 23, I want to be 23, whatever that is.
There are also developments in her personal life.
Taylor, you know I'm going to have to ask you about the love of your life, right?
Meredith.
How did you know I was going to do that?
She's just a little fuzzy cat, and she's so cute.
Meredith is the star of Taylor's tweets and a social media sensation. And with this...
You stop petting her?
She meowed her way to over 1 million hits on YouTube.
The thing about Meredith is she's like, she's just a cat, so she has no idea. She's really kind of famous. It's hilarious.
Good girl!
But Meredith the cat isn't all that's being talked about. This past summer, rumors of a swift romance with Connor Kennedy were the talk of the town. The paparazzi pursued them with abandon. They called them the new Camelot. Taylor's Summer of Love headlines were endless.
Can I just make one observation, though? It seems like you had a really fun summer. Is that accurate?
It was a great summer. The single came out and did so well, made the album. It's a great summer.
I know you don't talk about your personal life, and I want to respect that. But why are you so private about that?
I think, for me, I just think that my personal stories sound better in a song than in an interview, in quotes.
You, with your words like knives and swords and weapons that you use against me.
She says it all in her songs, but don't expect her to spill her guts about her private life. She doesn't want to talk about it, and she doesn't want to read about it.
It's not about, you know, what gossip is, you know, currently online, because I don't read any of that stuff.
Ever?
Not really, ever. I just have a huge priority on being happy. And for me, happiness does not include like Googling myself and checking what the minute-to-minute perception of me is right now.
For the young woman so in control of every move she makes, it's what she can't control that scares her the most.
Finish this sentence if you could. In 10 years, I will be...
32 and... Whoa, that's such a hard question.
Really?
It's like all my fears come out.
Like what?
Like, oh, like losing everything, like losing my friends and my family and like ending up alone and crying and stuff.
Let's take a more positive approach.
In 10 years, I will hopefully know, either have a family or know when I want to have one or something.
And professionally?
I have no idea. I just really don't want to do this after people get tired of me. I want to know when that line is.
Drop everything now.
And if I overstay my welcome, I'll go write songs for other people.
And still focus on being happy.
Yeah, I really want to end up happy. I just, that's the biggest thing for me.
Next, how Reba's first marriage almost ended her career when her husband said,
"Well, you've kind of peaked. That's it. Might as well just kind of hang it up."
And keep watching for a special announcement from Taylor Swift at the end of the show.